All right, what's up, guys? Welcome to the first Barricade Brothers podcast.
Glad you could join us. Anybody that watches this, essentially, what we're gonna be doing. Let's turn this TV down a skooch, huh? Essentially, what we're going to be doing is, while we're playing, we're going to do this once a week or every once in a while. While we're playing, we'll be playing a game, just a random game, and we're going to be talking about, just news stuff, things happening in PC world, Xbox, PlayStation 4, possibly other type of news. And we're just going to sit here and talk for, however long. Anybody watching on Twitch, if you have any questions, you go ahead and ask. And we'll try to answer them the best we can.
Yeah, definitely. So for today, we got a couple different topics we want to talk about. For one, I don't know if you guys have heard yet that someone has released on YouTube a video of a speedrun of The Order 1886. And he completed the game in, I think it was like 5 hours. And there's an uproar on the community saying that there are people arguing that the game is too short for what they want to charge for it, and that there's other people arguing that because it's so story-driven, the $60 is worth the game because they feel like the game's going to be a really good game. So I guess we can start talking about that. So what's your take on that? What do you think? Like, how long do you think a game should be for the price you pay for a full-price game? Like, what do you expect out of a game?
Well, obviously I want a game that's going to last more than 15-20 minutes, obviously.
1998.
To actually sit here and say that,
forget it.
I'd want a game,
it was the year
a game needs to be more than 5 hours of gameplay, or 10 hours or 15 hours. I think really for me it more so boils down to the experience.
Yeah.
Because
enterprise umbrella.
You can have a game that, you know, you could have 15 hours of gameplay in a game, but if you're not enjoying that game, then it doesn't matter how long it is, because you're probably not going to play that 15 minutes anyway. If there's a game that only has 3 or 4 hours of gameplay, but I absolutely love it, and even furthermore, if it's a game like, you have, say, your Far Cry games or Dying Light that just came out, once the game's done, the actual missions and everything, you can still run around. It's an open map, so you can still run around and do things.
Yeah.
You know, they have side missions and everything, which adds to the gameplay. But like I said, I guess for me, it's obviously I want a game that's going to last a decent amount of time. But
6 years.
I think the majority of it boils down to the gameplay itself, how well the game is made, and how much I'm going to enjoy it.
Yeah, no, that's kind of like my take on it. Like, for example, when I bought Skyrim for the first time, Skyrim is an open-world RPG. So I paid $60 for that. I have over 200 hours logged on that game on Steam.
Right.
But that's because of the fact that I play it on PC, and I can mod it. I can add new content people have created. Things left and right, so...
Well, yeah, but, I mean, when it comes to a game like Skyrim, it also, a lot of that... gameplay that you have is you walking from one area to another. So it kind of extends the gameplay when it takes time to move from one mission to the next.
Well, they also have fast travel, though.
Once you get there.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah. Well, I know they changed it from Oblivion, because in Oblivion, you had to get just the main cities. I believe you had to get to the main cities first.
Right.
Or no, I may be mistaken.
To fast travel.
No, I'm wrong. They actually changed. They used to be that way, and in Skyrim, they changed it so you have to go to the city first.
Right.
I was wrong. Well, yeah, it's like people argue that, length is important, but it's like unless you're going to sit down and play a game from beginning to end and you're trying to beat it as fast as possible, you're obviously going to get to the end as quick as possible. You're not going to get the most of the game if you're just playing the game. You start playing it, and then you just, one sitting, play through the end. You're not going to get your $60 worth, especially if you want to beat the game, and that's it.
Well, right, and that kind of goes back to, that's when I brought up Dying Light. I'm in this lonely and rural part of Europe. Was that guy standing on the side of the road taking a piss?
He is pissing on the side of the road, yes.
It's necessary to put in the game, I guess.
Well, it's all exposition. Leon's trying to recall back in Raccoon City and the zombie outbreak and all that.
Hey, man, the world is your oyster.
Yeah, right?
Look at that. It must be cold, too, because it's pretty steamy.
Yeah, this guy don't give a shit.
But, like, as you know, going back to the Dying Light, that's the whole thing. If you play the main storyline right through,
yeah,
there's probably only, you know, 5 to 10 hours of gameplay, and that's a $60 game. But yeah. They have side missions, and they have, you know, your other free run challenges and things like that, which add to the gameplay. Yep. So, and they were talking about 1884 multiplayer, weren't they?
Yeah, the thing is it's a single player only game.
Right.
There's no multiplayer aspect. So that's where most of the uproar is coming out. Like when people buy a game like Dying Light. Uh-huh. There's multiplayer to it.
Right.
So once you beat the main game, you can expand that into multiplayer and play with your friends or other people around the world.
Right.
So I can see where they're coming from. I do wish that if you're only... My opinion is if you're going to make a single-player only game, you need to focus on making that single-player only game the best possible game you can possibly make.
Right, not put out a mediocre product.
Yeah, so I mean, I'm probably going to try the 1886 out myself to see how it is. And the game might be amazing. Like, the game looks really interesting. Like, the story looks awesome. The gameplay looks amazing. So it looks like a really interesting, you know, game to play. And I can see why people are getting upset, though. Because, you know, if you're going to pay $60, you want to get more than a couple sittings of the game. Because once you beat the game, unless it has high replay value, like different things happening every time you start a new game. I mean, for me, like, games like Metal Gear Solid, like, the story is the same every single time. But you can approach things differently to get to beat the game differently. So I can run through the game in a half hour or a couple hours
just shoot everybody, right?
Or I can make it longer and play a new playthrough.
Do your actual stealth and
yeah,
right. Well, I think that's another thing, you know, with all your achievements that you have and everything too, because even after, you know, those aren't direct challenges or missions in the game. But when you add achievements to a game, it adds to the gameplay because you have these other things that you can try to accomplish where it's not going to give you anything necessarily in-game, but it gives you a little tag so you can point at your computer screen or your TV screen at some point and look at your friends and go,
Sir,
I have that tag.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
So,
yeah.
I mean, it's not anything major, but it's just, you know, small things.
Yeah, and
that added.
My biggest thing about single-player only game and multiplayer only games is if the developers of 1886 make it really well, it can work really well.
I was wondering if
but if you look at games like The Crew, the idea of the game is fantastic. I just love what they tried to do with it. Like an only online multiplayer racing game where you just drive around, other people can just like drive near you and you can just race people.
Right. Pull up at a light, somebody can pull up next to you.
Exactly. And that's my thing is like, but they executed it horribly. They made the game and it was not ready to come out yet. And they still released it.
Well, that's a problem with, you know, a lot of developers or a lot of, you know, well, smaller developers are trying to get their games out there to, you know, get seen. So they release them early access or they release the beta, you know, for sale at a low price and it's really buggy and, you know, that's good in some cases because it's good for developers to have community feedback, but another problem is if you're putting out an extremely broken game, then and you're just letting anybody get their hands on it, then depending on the time it takes you to get in and, you know, fix these bugs or make it better, it could turn people off to the game.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, it's... You know, War Z, Infestation, Survivor Stories.
That was a mess.
You know, I feel like that was hyped up so much. The developers, you know, well, not only did the developers, I don't want to call it lying, but the devs kind of stretched the truth when it came to what was in the game.
Yeah, like features when the game came out.
Right, for the release.
Yeah, no, yeah, definitely.
And, you know, that killed it a lot. But they promised all these things that they were going to deliver, and I personally got it when it was went into beta when it was first released. And it was an okay game when it started. It didn't have everything in it that, you know, they said it would when it started, but as you go along and they start talking about, we're going to add this thing and we're going to change these things, and, you know, 4 or 5 months later, they haven't done any of that. And then they finally come out with a update, and the update changes a bunch of stuff, but none of that. It's a real turnoff to the game. You know, you're not really seeing a whole lot of progress. So, I mean, it's a real double-edged sword, I think, when it comes to pre-releasing games into
early access
yeah. or you know, releasing a beta version. You know, you really got, I think the developers really got to look at their game and see where it's at and see what they're going to do with it before they decide if they're going to do a full early access release or just a numbered early access release. Because, you know, like I said, having community insight definitely helps, but to just unleash it to the entire community, I don't think is necessarily a good way to go all the time.
Well, my thing about early access is it falls in the developer's hands, but also falls on the player's hands. If you buy an early access game, you're buying into a game that you know is not complete yet. You know what I mean?
Right.
But in the same respect, they should not tell you something's in the game if it's not in the game.
Well, no, and I think that's just more so infestation.
Oh, yeah.
I really haven't seen that from any other game being released, you know, talking about you can do all these things in this game and only half of what they say you can do, you can actually do.
Yeah, another thing is some developers just don't know how to react to their games becoming popular and they kind of get a big head. Like the developers of Infestation, for example, like, once their game started taking off and they started selling a lot of copies of it because of the hype, they kind of turned into assholes. Like, when someone would complain about something on the forum, they would just ban them from
the forums.
Like, they wouldn't take any criticism. They think that their game is the end-all, be-all zombie game.
Well, and it may not even have been that. You know, a big part of it could have been, they were just getting so much of it.
Yeah.
You know, they were just being drowned in negative comments.
When you make a game like that, you have to expect that. You have to expect that you're going to make a game. No game is ever going to be perfect. Like, there are games that are close to it, in my opinion, but there's no game that's ever been perfect. You know?
No, any game I've ever played, no matter how good I thought it was, there were times where I've been like, oh, they could have done this.
Yeah, right.
So.
Exactly.
And, you know, when it comes to games themselves, too, perfect is really based on what the individual player is looking for, too.
Yeah.
You know, because two players can play the same game, and one could look at it and go, you know, it should really have this, or they should take this out, or whatever, and then the other person can play the same exact game, and they could disagree with that. I don't think it should have that. I think it's good how it is, but these parts could be changed.
Yeah, exactly.
So, the perfect game is only in the eyes of the player.
Exactly, and you know, when if with the people complaining about the length of the game of 1886, if you think it's too short of a game, then don't buy it.
Yeah.
I mean, it's up. You don't. If you don't think it's worth it, you don't need to buy the game. No one's forcing your hand and saying you need to buy this.
Or wait till it goes on sale.
Exactly. And the problem with that though is there aren't many sales that happen on consoles.
True.
So you know, the kind of uproar that we hear in games like this, it's not usually on the PC side because the game will eventually go on sale.
Yeah, so I guess really what it boils down to is you should probably get a PC.
PC Master Race. Well, that's the thing though, is like I have an Xbox. I bought an Xbox because some people that I want to play with, they just can't get into PC games. And like I said, PC games, it's not something for everyone.
Yeah.
Like, you have to be a special kind of person to play a PC game. And you have to be able to at least, like, have basic repair skills on a computer, otherwise it just won't work for you.
Right.
Give me a second, I kill this chainsaw dude. I think it's called, like, chainsaw or something.
Yeah, because PCs, one thing about PCs is a lot of times they're definitely not self-maintained.
Oh, no. And that's what's great about a console. Is a console, you plug it in and you have it. Like, it's there, you play it.
Right.
But in the same respect, with consoles, what's nice is usually they have a warranty. Like, PCs, every part has a warranty, But the thing with PCs is you have to find out which part is the problem.
Right.
And that's why people just love consoles.
Yeah, and if you don't have any knowledge or background in computers, it's not going to be easy for you to figure out.
Yeah, exactly. And, like, there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, like, my brother. My brother has no idea how to work on his computer at all.
Whoa, bro, I wasn't even there. What are you trying to pull?
Yeah, a couple stabs. Hi.
What? I don't, like, what's going on with these people?
They are a cult. And
they all dress the same, have the same haircuts. Basically.
Well, the main premise of this game... Oh, sorry if anyone does not play this, spoiler alert. The president's daughter is kidnapped. And the point is that you're the agent that they sent into the area where she was last seen to find her and bring her back home. Oh, nope. Nope. And so basically these people are the cult that kidnapped her. You don't know that yet in the game, but that's basically what's going on now. They're trying to kill you because they knew you were coming.
I guess they kind of have a very zombie-esque vibe to them.
Yeah, they do. And it gets later on, it gets to a point where there's a parasite that's inside them.
Oh.
And the parasite, they're controlled by the main bad guy in here. He controls them all. So that's basically the premise of it. You don't find that they're infected until later.
Right.
But as of right now, they're just humans that you're like, what? Why the hell are they attacking me right now?
Right.
And that chainsaw dude, I can't tell you how nerve-wracking it is to fight him the first time, because you saw how long it took me to kill him. And that was two frag grenades and a bunch of shotgun shells, and this fucker's still coming at me.
Right.
So,
Bingo?
So, yeah, I mean, that's the premise of this game.
And for, oh, what was that? That was just the,
That was, like, the intro part of the game.
Yeah.
And, this game throws you into it. Like... It doesn't give you a warning. You walk, first couple areas you walk into, you're already fighting one of the hardest enemies to fight. It's nice, it gives you a shotgun at the top of the thing, but if you don't know that shotgun's there, you're trying to kill that dude with a pistol.
Yeah, this dude is dressed way too fancy to be going around shooting people in the face.
I picked this this outfit because Ashley, the president's daughter, you're trying to save her, when you're going around with her, she has a suit of armor on so she can't get hurt. This is a special alternate costume, and when she's wearing that suit of armor, nothing can hurt her. So what I'll do is, to make it a little easier on myself, and parts with a bunch of enemies, or when I'm fighting that one boss, I'll have her wait, because you can give her commands, you can tell her to wait or follow you. I'll have her wait where the boss is, and I'll run away, and I'll turn around, and the boss keeps trying to pick her up and squeeze her, but it hurts his hand, so he just keeps trying over and over again, I'm just unloading bullets on his face.
Right.
So... But, yeah, so, I mean, it's kind of annoying. There's a gun in here called the Chicago Typewriter. It's an unlimited Tommy gun. And it's funny, because when you wear this suit, when you try to reload the gun in the in a regular outfit, he'll reload the gun. But when you're wearing this outfit and you have that gun, there's a round drum on it, and when you press the reload button, he kind of, like, fixes his hat. And he hit dude again, he fixes his head again, he do it a third time, he throws his head in the air, catches it, goes like that. It's pretty funny. But, yeah, no, this game's really awesome. I mean, I really enjoy it. I find it really fun. I bought this game, I think, every console it's come out on. It's been on GameCube first, that's where it came out on, and then it went on PS2. And they released a shitty port of it for PC, which I didn't buy because I didn't want to play a shitty port. And they finally re-released it, like, as an actual game for PC. I think I got it for, like, $5 on sale, too. PC Master Race.
PC Master Race.
But, yeah, so, I mean, that's really all I gotta say about the whole 1886 thing, is, like, if you don't like a game that can possibly be that short, or you don't like single-player-only games, that's not the game for you, then. Like, they make games, and they make games that they think that people want to play, and if, I mean, no one's going to play, not everyone wants to play this game, for instance.
Yeah, like not everybody wants to play every game, and you can't expect a company to, you know, try to make a game that is going to appeal to every single person out there, because it's just not, it's not possible, you know, they make games to target a group, that's what gets sales.
Exactly.
And, yeah. Whether...
What's that?
you know, the whole length of gameplay, that just, that could hit any group, you know, out there. That more so targets the person, an individual person themselves.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you don't think it's there's enough gameplay in the game, then, you know, don't spend $60 on it.
Exactly, and that's all I can think of to say about that. And honestly, if you're still kind of planning on getting it, just get it. I mean, I say that because I can get it myself, but, I mean, when I buy a game, I make sure that I really want that game before I buy it, regardless of on sale or not.
Right.
I mean, I have over 180 games on Steam, but that's because of Humble Bundles and all that. Like, Humble Bundles, they give you a bunch of games for one low price. So, I mean, that's why I have so many. But, like, I don't know. I don't see why people get so butthurt over small things, you know what I mean? Like, if you don't like it, don't buy it. You don't need to complain about it and, you know, bitch.
That's too simple.
Yeah, that's a good point.
That's way too simple. I'm checking out the top stories right now on IGN. Find every stray fairy in Majora's Mask 3D.
Oh, I'm actually really good at that.
Yeah, that's something else. I haven't played the Majora's Mask, and you actually got the new...
I got the new 3DS.
Right.
Majora's Mask Edition.
Yeah, the one, and the 3DS has that face-tracking 3D in it, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah. I was quite skeptical about how that would work. This game is Resident Evil 4, in case you're wondering. It's on Steam. That's what I'm playing on right now. I'm playing on my PC, just using the controller. But, yeah, it's just Resident Evil 4. Yeah, so I got the 3DS.
It's the Rebirth, right?
Well, yeah, they just remade it with HD textures and stuff. Why are you trying to dodge my laser, bro? You're still getting shot in the face. But basically...
Dude, can you imagine... You're just hanging out in your cult. Hanging out in the farm. Your cult farm. Look at that guy was over it. He was probably shucking some corn. And all of a sudden, some dude, dressed all fancy, with a nice hat, just comes through and shoots you in the face and then kicks you in the jaw.
And it stabs you until you die. Yeah, no problem, man. Yeah, but that new 3DS, the thing is freaking awesome. What it has is it's got the camera, and there's a little sensor next to the camera. And it calibrates, when you first turn the system on, it calibrates... It calibrates your face, like, to your face. And let's see if I can, no, that's not working. Can I do a pop-out? Pop-out. Yeah, there we go. So it kind of, like, calibrates to your face when you first turn it on. And it kind of shows you, like, when you're holding it and you move it, it shows you where your face is going in the calibration.
Let me play some of this shit.
Go ahead. So you aim down with that, and you shoot with X, and then the other trigger is for your knife. But what's sweet about just talking about Majora's Mask?
I work for KFC, bitch. Here I come.
You know, it's actually funny. If you scare them enough, they poop eggs.
Do they?
Yeah, you just pick up eggs. If you kill it won't. But.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
Anyways,
Kentucky, fuck you.
So I had with the new Majora's Mask 3D, I have one personal issue with the game. When they first announced it, they said that they would be making it a little bit more accessible to newer audiences.
Right.
Because when they released the game, it was way ahead of its time.
Okay.
Like, the concepts in it. First of all, the hardware of the 64. The hardware of the 64 cannot handle what they wanted to do with it.
Right.
So basically, you could only, if you wanted to save the game, you had to save it and quit. You couldn't keep playing after saving it.
Oh yeah, I remember that.
So,
thanks.
Bye.
See ya.
They changed that in this game, which I actually do. I do like that because you can save it and keep playing now because the hardware in the 3DS is years ahead of the 64.
Right.
And they made changes here and there to make it more accessible, and that's one of them I like. One of them I don't like is the how they changed how you get things. Like, they made it so, let's say, how do I explain this? There's one part that I remember it really bothered me. Oh, there's this part where you're at a Deku palace.
Okay.
And you're jumping from Deku flower to Deku flower to get across. And if you were to... you have to kill...
Don't kick the ladder, dumbass.
It said kick down. You can actually open those containers, and there's stuff in them. There might be stuff in them. Sometimes there's not.
Gold. I don't need a rotating 3D image of what I just picked up. Thanks. You can just tell me. There's a barrel here. Looks like it can be broken. Well, then let's do it.
But, yeah, so there was, like, the Deku Palace part. You're jumping from flower to flower, and you have to make it to the end. If you fall off, you have to start all over.
All the way back at the beginning.
Yeah.
Freaking hate games like that.
I hated it, too, but it made it challenging. It made it so you... it gave you that feeling of, I need to make it, otherwise I gotta start all over again. Like, it made you... it put you on the edge of your seat.
Right.
To finish that part. That's what I liked about Majora's Mask. There were a lot of parts in the game where... unlike Ocarina of Time before it, Ocarina of Time, I can sit down and I can beat in one sitting, and it is not difficult for me.
Right.
But Majora's Mask was the game I played, and when I played it at first when I was younger, when I first got it, I couldn't get into it because it was too difficult for me. It wasn't until I was like 13 or 14 that I could actually sit down and play it and actually play it well.
I sat down and started playing it like 2 years ago, and I ended up fucking something up to where... I don't remember what it was. I removed something or did something that made it so I couldn't progress in the game.
Yeah, it has that. And this game took that out. Like, the remake took stuff like that out where if you fucked up, you could just keep going.
Well, see, that's good for me.
Well, no, like I said, it's good. What I think they should have done is they should have made two versions of it on the release.
Yeah.
One, just vanilla, how the game was when it came out, and then one, updated to make it more accessible.
Right.
Because the problem with me is I'm playing it...
Dirty Pearl.
And where I, Pearl. As many times I've beaten it on the Nintendo 64.
Yeah.
If I sit down and play it, I can't sit down in one sitting and beat it.
Right.
It's still too difficult. Like, it's the difficulty, you don't learn how to do it. It's kind of like, it's difficult no matter how many times you do it. In this one, I'm already at the last level, and I just got the game the other day. And that's with me only playing it like a half hour at a time or an hour at a time. And like I said, they made so many changes, and most of them are good. It's just some of them I don't like.
Oh.
But I will say, there is a part in the console version, which was actually easier than the 3DS. They actually changed this and made it a little harder.
Yeah.
There's a mask in the game called the Stone Mask. And the Stone Mask makes you invisible. Don't kill the dog.
What?
He'll help you later on in a boss fight.
Oh, man.
But, what was I saying? There's a part, the Stone Mask makes you invisible to enemies. They won't attack you because they can't see you. You used to be able to get the Stone Mask before this part in the game where you... there's a part in the game called the Pirate's Fortress where you have to go around sneaking. You can't just go rushing in and fight everyone. You have to sneak through, otherwise you get kicked out. The Stone Mask lets you go through that without being seen, so you could get through it pretty easily.
Right, and they changed it so you can't get that.
Yeah, they changed it where you have to get inside the Pirate Fortress to get that mask.
Right.
And I did like that, though. It made it refreshing. Because I actually went to that where I thought it was, because I went to where it was in the 64 version, and there's no one there. I was just like, and I read up on it. The guy's inside the fortress. I was like, damn, that's actually going to be kind of tough. It's a quick time event, and it's going to ask you to push two buttons together. It's either going to be the two triggers or A and X. There you go. Yeah, those parts are the worst. That rock hits you and you just whoah, and you're dead.
Quick action. Gotta love quick action. Let's fill this up. Is that flashing because I'm low on ammo?
Yeah, and you're holding your... no, you're low on health. That little yellow bar is your health.
Do it have health kits or anything?
You have herbs. You just press start. It opens up your case. And I'd use the... I'd match the... press Y over one of the herbs and then move it over to above the yellow one. And press Y again. No, oh, that's a green one.
Red.
No, okay, so the yellow... if you mix a green herb... what a green herb does is it's a low health refill. and red, you can't use the red or the yellow individually. You can only use the green individually. You mix the green with the yellow and the red. If you mix a green with the red, it fills up your health completely.
Mm-hmm.
If you mix a green with the yellow, it fills up your health moderately, but also increases your max health. So now you have to wait until you get another green one to be able to use that. And that'll fill up your health and increase the max health. Just use that golden egg. Gold chicken egg. But, yeah, so... Like I said, I'm not going to say that I hate the re-release of Majora's Mask because it's one of my favorite games of all time. And I think that they did a fantastic job remaking it. There's only a couple things I didn't like about it.
Right.
But,
Wait, is this what I just left?
Did I go the wrong way? Yeah, you...
Son of a... Hey.
Yeah, so, Yeah, what was that thing you wanted to talk about? Something about Ninja Day?
Oh, yeah. So I don't know if anybody of you are interested, but Sunday is Japan's National Ninja Day. it's not a, what do they call those, a certified holiday or anything like Christmas or anything like that. But, they celebrate...
These guys are going to throw grenades at you. Be careful.
They celebrate ninjas and the...
If you shoot that grenade in his hand, it'll blow up in his hand.
I don't know if I'm going to be able to get it. It'd be nice if I could...
It'll highlight the red dot over it if you're over it. Headshots are fine, too. He's not dead, though.
Oh, yeah, that's... Whoa! Oh, whoa!
There's one over there, too. Careful, those are bombs.
Oh, I see it.
Oh, it's bombs. So. There are bear traps on the ground.
I see that, too. You got the spinal. Whatever that is. Oh!
Let's watch some porn. Watch how you're about to die.
Yeah, for sure. Here, I'm gonna... Yeah, so Sunday is National Ninja Day in Japan. I bookmarked this. Let me look this up real quick. Sunday, February 22nd. Well, not an official holiday. It is the recognition of ninjas and their place in history.
That's pretty cool. I mean, that's interesting. Japan would be the country to do that, though.
I'm getting a phone call that I have to take real quick.
Let's go throw another one, guy. Come on, guy. There you go. And that's how you do it. And there's another one. Come on, man. How did that not work? Come on. Go ahead, lady. Bam! Alright. Let's get up in there. Give me some of that. Take that hand, Grenizzle. Alright.
Sorry.
You're good.
Okay. Alright, So anyway, yeah, they're celebrating, Ninja Day. And, essentially, their history and their influence on even... You know, today, you know, pop culture today, you see ninja crap all over the place.
Well, yeah, there's like TV shows and stuff now, like, if not just parodies, but like actual TV shows, like, they even made a freaking obstacle show, like, what do you call that, a challenge show?
Oh, yeah,
American Ninja Warrior. Oh, shit, I missed that. Wasn't paying attention, man.
Or, you know, the original Ninja Warrior, which is from... I think that was originated over in Japan.
Oh, really?
Ninja Warrior.
That's interesting.
I think it was Japan. One of those. But the cities of Iga and Koka are behind the holiday, and that is actually both towns are historic ninja strongholds.
Don't you think?
So, I thought that was kind of cool. America likes to do stuff like that them? Too, make up holidays.
No.
Like, Sweetest Day.
Yeah, Sweetest Day.
Only Japan makes up holidays to celebrate ninjas and their history. And America makes up holidays to sell fattening donuts and,
the big cheese.
Sweetest Day cards, Hallmark cards. Oh.
This dude is really bad. When you fight him later on in the game, it's probably one of my favorite fights in the game. It's hard, dude. I die. If we get to it today, I'll probably die a couple times.
You got dunked on, son.
Yeah. So, let's say you had to pick one game that you think is the most underrated game of all time. What do you think that is?
Underrated?
Underrated. Like, I mean, a game like, I mean, I'd say a game like Majora's Mask. Like, when it came out, it was horribly underrated. Like, no one thought it was a good game. Everyone's like, oh, it's the worst Zelda ever. And now, they're remaking it. Like, they've remade it now because it's so popular.
Right.
Like, when, like, underrated, my thing is, some games are underrated, I feel like, because they come out ahead of their time. Like, people aren't ready for the game that they've made, or the hardware that they're making the game on is not up to what it needs to be.
Right.
You know, they made like a virtual reality Xbox One game. Like, Xbox One's gonna be able to play that.
Or even the gameplay type. Man, underrated game, huh?
Humans, let us give you
I don't know.
Power.
That's a tough one.
Underrated.
I could probably give you a handful of overrated games.
Yeah, I could too. I could definitely do that. What's funny is me and Clay actually played Call of Duty last night. That was a good time. Not really. He's really bad.
At Call of Duty?
He's so bad.
Really?
Yeah, I was shocked. I mean, I told him too. It was funny because he actually brought up the point. He's like, now I know how you guys feel when we play Counter-Strike. Hey, I was like, that's exactly how we feel, dude. Well,
how we guys feel. Dude, in Counter-Strike, I go like 4 in 100.
Oh, Counter-Strike.
I think the last time I played with Claser Beam, my record was like, when I stopped playing, it was because it was, you know, the never-ending deathmatch.
Yeah.
Name's Leon.
I think it was like 140 in like 12.
Seen her.
I know, it's really bad.
Oh, that was Clay? Or you want 140 deaths and 12 kills?
140 deaths and 12 kills.
Okay.
Oh, no, Clay was like
160 and 5.
Clay was like 100, like 110 maybe.
Yeah, he's really good at the game. He's really good at it.
Well, it's really fast-paced. That's what drives me nuts.
It's fast-paced, and I think the physics are wonky. It's the way you have to kill people.
Yeah.
Like, I when I'm playing a game with guns, it's first person, I like to be able to take the gun and go. Nah.
Yeah. Yeah. Like the hip shots. Shooting from the hip.
I can't shoot from the hip.
Let's see what else we can find here. Look up some PC news.
Who happens to be quite the ladies man?
Have you heard of the game Star Citizen?
No.
Why don't you look it up real quick? Star Citizen, this game dev company is they're actually in the process of it. I think that early access is out now. You can play it, I think. It's like a space adventure game, like an open world space MMO.
That actually sounds pretty cool.
It actually looks awesome. Like it's the way the model, the game model is. It's not like a regular game. You don't just pay a one-time fee and play the game.
That is the incident of the viral outbreak.
There's different packages you can buy. And different packages are for different ships.
Okay.
Like, you get a ship, that's your ship.
Right.
And I think that's awesome, because, like, then there's ways, you can probably find ships, no ship's going to be the same.
After you.
I mean, especially if you customize it. But,
Wow, you almost got murdered during idle conversation.
Dude.
And next app.
He's like, fuck this shit. That guy's insane.
Right.
His face, though. That was awesome. And just instant clothes change. Costume change.
It's Leon.
Cut.
Sorry.
Alright, so, yeah, Star Citizen looks really, really interesting.
Over here.
Strange, huh? This is where they actually made a reference in Magisite about that with the merchant. He's like, what can I get, or... what are you buying, Stranger?
Oh, yeah.
It's awesome.
We're gonna follow this guy. He better at least have candy.
I hate this part of the game. But yeah, like I said, Star Citizen looks really interesting. And, but what I don't know exactly how the game works, per se. Like, I don't know if it's an online MMO in terms of, like, fighting people, or... You know, like kind of like a War Z type thing.
Or more like a Minecraft.
Yeah, and I'm sure they're probably going to make it once it's done, where you can do either or. Like, join a server of just exploring
the
solar system and all that jazz.
PvP and PvE.
What are you selling?
Yeah. So, yeah, at this part of the game, when I play this, I try my best to not spend any money until I get to the next part of the game, because there's three areas of the game. There's the village, there's the castle, and then there's the, what's it called, facility? Kind of like a, I don't even know how to explain it, like a factory or something like that. Like, that's the best way I can explain it.
Right.
And until you get to the castle, which is like the second third of the game, he gets all new weapons, like to buy a new pistol, revolver, a semi-automatic sniper rifle, all that stuff. So I do my best to save all my money until I get to that point. And that's why I think I struggle sometimes, like with that one boss. That one boss that just grabbed my foot and launched me.
Yeah.
When you fight him, he actually isn't that hard of a boss, but when I get to him, I still have this pistol and I have the original shotgun. So... What I like about this, though, is you can kick them off the ledge if you time it right.
Okay, so... Apparently, the CEO and CEO of Paradox sat down and, started discussing what they're gonna focus on. And they're talking... They're talking about making more games like Goat Simulator and less in the lines of Call of Duty.
Really? Who is this?
This is Paradox.
Remind me, what do they make? I don't remember.
I don't know, I'll look that up. But they're basically talking in the aspect of, you know, you have all these game development companies coming out with, you know, games like Call of Duty. You got Call of Duty, Titanfall, Battlefield, you know, all these games like that. And they're basically saying in today's society, you need more games like Goat Simulator.
Yeah.
You know, because they stand out. There's less like them. They're edgier. Paradox Interactive.
You're gonna say that I'm gonna feel like a moron. There you go.
Yeah. I'm sure they.
Come over here so we can eat you.
City Skyline. Oh, they make Magicka. Let's see here. Games. They make books, too. I guess. I don't know. Not a whole lot of...
It sounds familiar. I just don't remember.
Doesn't look like a whole lot of popular games. Magicka, I know. Cities in Motion. They're the makers of Cities in Motion.
Well, they didn't make Call of Duty type games in the first place. Why are we...
And because they're probably not selling the garbage that they put out now.
Yeah, that's true.
Can we...
Try to think,
I'm trying to see if I can put these in order of popularity. They have a DLC for $119.
Well then, which one? What is it? You're looking at Star Citizen?
Crusader Kings 2 DLC. The game itself, Crusader Kings 2 Limited Edition, Royal Edition, is $400.
Oh, you brought up, Titanfall. Respawn Entertainment, they're not making Titanfall a Microsoft exclusive anymore. It's coming out on PS4, it's coming out, it's going to be a multi-plat now.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. They, I don't know what happened, but apparently, because of how horribly the Xbox is doing when it came out, when Titanfall came out, they didn't sell nearly as many as they could have because they weren't making it on the PS4. But, yeah, they're making it a multiplayer now, so that's going to be pretty cool. It's going to introduce the game to a wider audience. Oh, shoot.
Yeah, Paradox.
Bam!
Paradox says, people are tired of explosions and dubstep music. We've seen it a million times now. Like, stop doing it. No more. So they're just thinking more outside the box. They're gonna start thinking more outside the box.
Well, that's refreshing. I mean,
average, straightforward game.
Like my favorite game right now, or not even right now, just like one of my favorite games of all time is Faster Than Light. And can you name another game that's like Faster Than Light? They nailed it. Like they took a concept that no one ever used.
And I think Faster Than Light is probably one of the best games I've ever played.
It's one of the most well-designed games that I've played in a long time. And that's the thing, it's so simple too. There's no crazy textures, no crazy graphics. The gameplay isn't that crazy, there isn't much to do. I mean, the idea of the game's simple enough, and it works. It works really well. The next page on Chrome.
Do do.
All right, here. Go ahead and play this for a minute. I'm going to run to the restroom. There was one.
I know. And then there was a couple. Alright. And I haven't the slightest idea where I'm supposed to go. Well, that was fast. Is there a fucking ladder around here somewhere? What the hell is this guy doing? Can I open this box? Bitch. Fuck your ladder. Why do they add... Yeah, pimpin', let's do this. Raise up! What? I don't understand why they add a jump down. Quick action when you want to get down.
It makes it feel more action.
Why can't you just fucking walk off the ledge? I'll tell you, that's definitely one thing that I hate in games is an overuse of quick action sequences.
Quick time events bother me.
It's just stupid. Like I said, you're standing on a ledge and you have to hit X in order to jump down. when in 90% of other games you play, you just keep walking forward and the dude jumps off the ledge.
Yeah, all by himself. He doesn't need help.
Hit X to climb.
Whoa.
Wait a minute. Oh, there he is.
If he grabs you, he's gonna explode.
Oh. Oh no, he's not.
Jump down!
Yeah, I'm gonna shoot him from down here. I'm not a big fan of the controls in this.
No, they're very wonky.
Yeah, they're weird. Oh, good. Yep, saw that coming. No, he killed himself.
No, that wasn't him. He's still up here.
Yeah, it was. Oh, no, it's not. Oh, jeez.
There is... Oh, first aid spray. Don't use that. Just use your... go to your menu and use a double herb that you made. No, that I used that, so you're going to have to use a first aid spray. Never mind.
We have two of them.
Oh, yeah. I didn't realize.
First aid spray. Oh, it feels so much better.
Bullet wounds are gone.
Dude, you need to... Alright, you're pissing me off.
She was like, oh, there you go. And I'll shoot the grenade. Oh, there we go. He's done. He finished.
Dude, I'm almost dead again, and he blew this door off. Is there anything in here?
Yeah, you can open
shovel.
You can open those, lockers.
Take the marijuana.
So, let me pull this back up real quick. Let's get something.
Why does the video look so shitty?
I don't know. Probably because we're doing 60 frames per second. Mm. Did we increase that? I think we increased it.
Yeah.
I think we decreased it. It looks good though. Like, it's smooth.
Could be the internet connection too.
Oh, they're making Just Cause 3.
Oh yeah, I already knew about that. Bethesda's actually, they think Bethesda's gonna unveil it at E3.
Oh, really?
Right, was it E3?
Is it E3? I don't know. Not quite sure. Let's see though.
Oh, look.
Go ahead and pause the game.
Yeah, E3.
Electronics Entertainment Expo.
The trailer's out. But I believe this is, it'll be Bethesda's first year.
Making that?
Yeah.
Yeah, probably.
Oh, no, Bethesda. No, I'm sorry, Bethesda's Fallout. That's what they're unveiling at E3.
Oh, dude, if they make a new Fallout, oh.
Four-player co-op. Will Bethesda announce Fallout 4 at E3 2015? Bethesda hasn't gone. As far as I know, Bethesda's never been to E3.
Really? I thought somebody would announce their stuff like Skyrim and all that jazz.
Bethesda announced last week that for the first time ever, they will hold their own E3 press conference. There are many rumors swirling around. Maybe they may have been to E3, but they've probably never held a press conference at E3.
Oh, yeah, yeah, like being one of the main contributors to it.
There are many rumors swirling around that we could finally hear confirmation about Fallout 4.
Fallout 4. That game is going to be awesome.
Yeah, what? 9 years after the release? No.
No. More like 6 or 7.
7. Came out in 08. Possibly a new single player Elder Scrolls. A new Dishonored. And, you know that they're redoing Doom.
Yes, I do know that.
That's
should
gonna
be interesting. It's going to be very, very interesting.
Yeah, I'm excited to see that. Hopefully that's not blown up more than it's worth. I played Doom when I was younger. You know, it was one of the first PC games I played. Doom, Catacomb Abyss. What else? I remember The Incredible Machine back in the day, which actually the developers of that are the same developers for Contraption Maker. Dude, is that focused? Because it looks out of focus, doesn't it?
It's zoomed in. That's why. Because look how far away we have it zoomed in.
Yeah.
We gotta come up with a better system for this.
Yeah, that's alright. It's our first podcast. It'll get better as we go. So we'll see what happens with that. We'll see if there's a Fallout 4 co-op, four-player co-op Fallout 4. And we'll see if Bethesda actually does a E3 press conference.
Yeah, we'll definitely have to watch out for that. We're actually trying to go to PAX next year.
PAX so would be fun.
We're going to have to see how we go about that. I know that they only let, press in to those things. So we'll probably have to...
It's probably not hard to get... It may not be hard to get a press pass.
Well, no, all you have to say is we technically are entertainers on YouTube. So I'm pretty sure that's
good. Technically.
Enough. Technically.
I'll just walk up to him and be like, apparently you don't know who the fuck I am. I'm Orphis.
Yeah. All right. Anyways, guys, I think that's all we got for you today, unless you got something else to add.
No, what's our running time at?
We're about an hour.
About an hour in?
Yeah, 56 minutes.
I was just going to talk about, I was just looking up some stuff on Just Cause 3. Oh, one thing I did read about Just Cause 3 was how they're not putting a multiplayer in it.
They're probably going to do what they did before.
Well, and that's essentially what the devs said, and the head of Avalanche Studios basically said that as hectic as Far Cry already is in the game itself, adding in a multiplayer to be able to play with other people when you're trying to complete missions and stuff, you got to do one thing, somebody blows something up, interrupts your missions. You know, it's just always, it's already so hectic, and anybody that's already played the Just Cause 2 multiplayer,
it's just all hell.
Oh,
there's no rhyme or reason. It's just people doing shit everywhere, like flying boats across the
world. Right,
it's
just utter chaos. So,
well, that's the thing with it. What people wanted it to be. So that's what they made it. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like they shouldn't do a whole mix and match. They shouldn't make it an all online game for one, because that's a horrible idea in a game like Just Cause.
Yeah.
But and they should at least make a standalone multiplayer like they did for Just Cause 2.
Right, and that's essentially what they were saying in the aspect of they're not going to spend any time making a multiplayer game. There's no point in doing so when he knows that the community can just make one themselves. And it's just, there's just such utter chaos in the game already that adding another person or another two, three people in there, when you're running through the game trying to complete missions, it's just going to be ridiculous. And they've even reached out to, basically saying that they love the community, that they're doing what they can, and they're going to add what they can to the game to make things easier on people that will build a mod for a multiplayer mod for the game. Which is great that developers nowadays are starting to more so welcome modding in their games as opposed to just having to deal with it.
Yeah, and like even if they don't have anything against mods, they don't do anything to help you, and then they make it harder for you to add those mods in your game because they're not doing anything to help you do it. Like Skyrim did it right. Bethesda knows what they're doing when it comes to modding.
Right.
They give you tools to say, hey, you can use this, make your own shit. We want you to. We want to see what you guys can do.
Right.
And what's nice about that is if you want to get into that field, like to make that your career, people can see that you know what you're doing.
If you have a mod out there that works flawlessly and it adds, you know, either a lot or a brand new major aspect to the game, people are going to eat that up.
Oh, of course, dude. I definitely feel that.
And especially in the aspect of a lot of times these mods are created by a single person. It's not a person who has a team of developers that can all focus on one thing and do this. It's one person or maybe two people making this mod that could essentially change the entire gameplay of whatever it is that you're playing.
Yeah, like there's a one mod in particular, it's called Enderall. It's basically adding a new game to an already existing game. And that's the kind of thing where they see someone like that, they might hire that person. They say, you want a job here? We'll give you a job here if you know what you're doing.
Oh yeah, yep.
And yeah, that's the thing. It's like even GTA. When GTA 4 first came out on PC, it was a shit port. It did not work.
Right.
It was the most awful thing. And what's nice about GTA 5 coming out is they've already said that they're giving mod support. They're putting stuff in to help you mod the game.
Oh, yeah. And they've also pushed back the release date months at a time in order to put out a perfect product, or close to perfect as they can get.
That's what I'm saying. Is if, like with Watch Dogs. The thing with Watch Dogs and like, is they pushed the release date 6 months, the game came out, it was still shitty.
It was a mediocre game.
Like, for the amount of time that they said they're putting into it, it did not give. Like, there were videos showing E3s, like, how the game looked at E3. And when the game came out, even on ultra settings on PC, it came nothing close to what it looked like at E3. So, I mean, you should watch out for that and pay attention.
But, yeah, I mean, it seems as though the game companies and developers are starting to give the community more tools and the necessary tools needed to do mods. I believe at one point Notch created Minecraft.
He
was talking about it, and I'm aware Notch at this point has sold Minecraft to Microsoft, and we'll see what goes from there. But at one point he was even discussing making it easier to add mods onto Minecraft, making it easier to develop and, you know, for regular people who are just playing Minecraft, add them into the game so they can actually, you know, you take advantage of them. Another one is Dying Light. In an upcoming update, I don't know exactly when they plan on releasing it, when it's coming out, or anything like that, but they have discussed already releasing a mod...
DLC expansion?
Yeah, what... why can't I think of what it's called? A development kit for Dying Light.
That'd be sweet.
And for Dying Light, that's major because that's essentially like having a development kit for Far Cry, you know, or having a development kit for Call of Duty. Obviously, multiplayer. You know, they probably wouldn't do a development kit for multiplayer, but for the campaigns, you know, it's a big thing to me. To me, that is a very huge thing because most of the time your mods come out for your, you know, lower quality games. You know, they still may be games made by a well-known production a game company, but, you know, in my opinion, Just Cause 2... when you look at the gameplay, how it's played, and the storyline, and the missions and everything, even though it's still a really, really fun, chaotic game, it's, I'd say it's lower
on the... production value.
Right, it's lower on the food chain than a Dying Light, Far Cry,
Battlefield. When they made Just Cause, they made it to be kind of a parody of video games.
Okay.
Like, that's my opinion. I don't know if that's for real how they thought about it, but in my opinion, what I look at the game as is kind of like a parody of a parody. It's a parody of a game like GTA.
Right.
It's like a super crazy, like, showing of how that game is in an even more crazy fashion.
Right.
Like, I'm grappling onto a boat that's flying in midair.
Yeah.
Right. You know what I mean? And for what it is, it's a fantastic game.
It is. It is. But, you know, like I said, when it comes to the food chain of gamings, you know, it's lower on there.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
And like I said, for them to start releasing development kits for games like Dying Light, it's just going to, I mean, it's going to blow the doors of gaming wide open. You know what I'm saying? It's going to give these really high quality, fantastic $60 games. And let's just go back to when we were discussing earlier with 1889. They release a development kit for that.
That whole argument of being too short is shot out of the water.
Yeah, because you'll just have thousands of hours of content that other people have created. So, yeah. You know, when it comes to modding and things like that, I think that all the game development companies out there should do their best to help communities be able to create mods for games. Obviously, you're going to have, you know, your you can only do so much. You're going to have your break-off points where, obviously, like I said before, when you have your Call of Duty or your Battlefield, stuff like that, you're not going to allow modding in that unless, you know, separate servers.
Yeah, exactly. Own servers. Like, not ranked servers or not servers where random people can get thrown in something they don't know. Like, it has to be a playlist, downloadable content.
Right.
But the problem with games like that, which is what Valve does really well with, like, Counter-Strike and, like, mods for Counter-Strike. Like, when you're playing Garry's Mod and you join a game, it downloads everything you need for that game before you can join the game.
Right.
A lot of games don't do that, though. Like, a lot of games like Call of Duty, they usually don't let you play with people that have map packs that you don't have.
Right.
They alienate people. And that's why I feel like as a group
open
of companies...
Modding.
Yeah, like, as a group of developers... They need to decide whether or not they want people to want their game more, or if they want to have more control over their ecosystem.
Right.
Because games like Garry's Mod, it's in the name. It's meant to give you freedom to do whatever you want.
Right. And the only problem is with Garry's Mod is you're given the tools to do it, but you're essentially creating the game from scratch. Whereas if these developers give the tools needed with the game they have, you already have the base game, and then you can just add the things to it that you want to add, change the way the game works, the way you want it changed, and like I said, I think it would just open up a million possibilities.
Well, yeah, like, definitely. Like you said, games like Dying Light, if they made a mod kit for that, or a development kit, or something to create your own content, the game itself already has a buttload of content.
Right.
So now you're taking a $60 game that you paid for, and you're getting what you paid for, but now you're making it so... Hey, Jumped, how you doing today, man? Welcome to the channel. We're just, you know, talking about some stuff today. What was I saying? I know what you're saying. Like, if all big games, like big open world games, made dev kits for people to use, like... Like, Bethesda did a really good job, because Bethesda, they did it from the get-go. They did it from, I believe, Morrowind.
Okay.
Since Elder Scrolls 3, I believe. I don't know, because I started playing at 4. But even 4, they came out with the creation kit. And the creation kit basically gave you the tools they used to make the game.
Right.
With all the objects they used, all the, everything they used.
How Violet has opened up and...
And the, what am I trying to say? Like, games of Downlight, so like games like Far Cry. I think Far Cry made something like that. I think. Don't quote me on that, but I do think.
Made something like what?
Like a mod kit for Far
Cry.
Well,
what they did was they released with Far Cry 4, at least I got
Sometimes
it with Far Cry 4. It was a development kit for
the
multiplayer
Fisher-Price
maps.
4-in-1 rock and glide soother.
Oh, yeah, you might be right. Yeah.
With two
and
ways
that is
to rock
the,
and two ways to glide. It soothes your...
It was, go away. Jeez.
That's why I just have it here, because the speakers are off here.
But they made a development kit for multiplayer maps. And the kit was actually, I personally thought the kit was amazing. And that's kind of what I'm going back to that with the whole developers releasing development kits or making it easier for people to mod their games, because you could make, you know, anybody can go into Gary's mod and make a multiplayer PvP map. But it's going to take an extremely long time to do so, because you have to build everything. You got to choose your, you know, the characters that are used in it, how everything works, you know. Whereas with the Far Cry 3 multiplayer map development kit, you essentially pick a random map, and then you have all these items. You know, buildings, textures. You can change the, you can change the map in the aspect of the terrain and add trees, and you can add all this stuff. But the basis of the game is already there. The shooting, you know, the deathmatch, team deathmatch. You know, the gameplay and everything is just there. You're essentially creating what you want to run through and what you want to play in. So,
yeah, like I said, with like games like GTA, it's already an open world game with you can do anything you want.
Right.
Adding a mod kit, the possibilities are just endless. Like, there's literally nothing that game can't be. You can turn that game into a first person hack and slash.
Oh, with Grand Theft Auto especially.
Yeah, because even they've made the first person mode. They've made it so you can literally do with a mod kit in that game whatever the hell you want to do in that game.
Right.
And that's why I think that mod kits for games like that are just phenomenal. Like, they're probably the best marketing. You can use that as a marketing tool.
Yeah, you could.
We have a dev kit for our game now that we're releasing with the game.
Yep.
So,
I would
you don't
be
like
more,
our game? Fix it.
I would be more likely to spend money on a game that I know for a fact somebody can and eventually will mod, than a game that, and you know, obviously it's not a major decision. I don't sit around looking at games thinking to myself, okay, well, is somebody going to be able to mod this? Because if they're not, I don't want any part of it. But in the aspect of, if I see that, oops, sorry guys, I'm messing with stuff I probably shouldn't be. If I see a game and it states right there that you can, you know, it comes with a mod kit or it's mod compatible, then I'm more likely to check it out, because not only do I have what...
I think you do like chicken.
Yeah.
I like chicken too, though. So.
If you were to have been around earlier, Flappy, I killed a chicken, and I do indeed like chicken, especially fried chicken. Or lemon pepper chicken's also good. Chicken parmesan.
Chicken Alfredo.
Chicken Alfredo.
Chicken's basically good with anything, so.
Almost anything.
Almost.
But yeah, you know, I'd really like to see more companies releasing development kits with their games.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, so, long story short, a game is what you make it.
A game is definitely what you make it. If we want to go back to what we were originally talking about when we first started the stream, which was if 1884 with only
1886.
I'm sorry, 1886 with only 5 hours of gameplay is going to be worth the $60. And...
Flappy, we're just trying to get some eggs, dude. We're low on health, and
yeah, we
thought killing the chicken would give us an egg, but I told him all you gotta do is scare the chicken.
I'm not gonna sit here and lie. I didn't even know that the chicken might give me an egg. I just wanted to shoot it.
Wow. Wow. All right. Anyways,
PETA's gonna have a field day.
Yeah. So,
But if going back to when we first started the stream,
Flappy, I haven't personally played Evolve yet, but what I've been hearing about Evolve is if you're playing with your friends, it can be fun, but it can get frustrating if you're playing by yourself and you get put on a team that's bad. It's kind of like even like Call of Duty. If you get put on a team that's bad, the game's not going to be as fun as if you got put on a good team. But if you play with your friends, you know how to strategize. It works better because there are a lot of teams that when you play online in that game, there are a lot of teams that know what they're doing. And you playing by yourself and not working together with your team, they're going to completely destroy you. So, I mean, if you have a bunch of people to play with, I'd say it's worth it. I'm probably eventually going to get it myself. I personally, myself, don't feel like it's worth $60 right now. That's just my opinion, though. Just with the way they've released it, because they released it with content already made that they didn't put in with the game. They wanted you to pay extra for the content. So that's just my stand on that.
I think a lot of times, for me, it's really hard to buy a game that was just released.
Yeah. Honestly, there's a lot of games that I don't even feel are worth $60.
Well, and I think this is more so... No, Flappy, you're all right.
No, you're good, man. I mean, we appreciate it. It gives us something else to talk about.
So. Although you did just... make me forget what I was saying, but you're all right.
That's fine.
I was saying more. I think more so buying games when they're just released for PC is a little more risky, simply for the fact.
It's a gamble.
Yes, yeah, simply for the fact that with bugs and everything. A lot of times I like to wait a month or two after a release to see if they can iron out some of the stuff, because the developers cannot create every single situation that you can run into a game.
Yeah, exactly.
To find bugs and everything. The only way that happens is once the community gets their hands on it.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I mean.
Flappy, if... we can, at some point in the next couple weeks, try to pick up Evolve, and we'll give it a play, put up some gameplay videos, and you can check that out if you're worried about.
I see the mouse real quick.
If you're worried about buying it now.
Yeah, actually, we're gonna be putting this up on our YouTube page, so if we do get Evolve and play it, it's gonna be going up there. Let me put the link to our page down there real quick. What am I on right now? Am I on mine? Yeah. Whoa. So, I'm actually sometime in the near future going to be doing a year stream challenge, where I'm going to try to stream every single night for an entire year. And depending on how that goes, me and Justin over here, we actually we're working on our YouTube channel right now, which is the link I just posted. So we're trying to make kind of like an entertainment center for people to just watch our content. So he's going to be focusing on more of the YouTube side of things. Like we're going to be making a lot of footage for him to put up. And then I'm probably going to be trying to do the Twitch thing. So, I'm still trying to map out how I'm going to do it, because I do work a full-time job and he's going back to work full-time soon. So, we're trying to figure out, we're just trying to get as much content done right now as we can. So, we're going to be trying to do a podcast every week, and it may not be on the same day, but once, we're not blood brothers, but we're brothers.
Right. Like, we're
brothers.
We're not born from the same parents, but...
we're definitely brothers.
It's about as close to a brother as you can get.
Yeah.
No. We are not gay together.
But so we're going to be working on Twitch as well as YouTube. Right now we're trying to focus on YouTube. So once we get that rolling together and everything, I'm going to start focusing more on the Twitch side of things. So give us a follow. I mean, if you like our content on YouTube, go ahead and subscribe. Because if you want to watch a nice shirt...
Blue crate shirt.
Nice top.
I'm wearing the same one right now.
No, you're fine, Flappy. I mean, there's nothing wrong with being gay. We're not, but
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with it. It's just not my choice.
Yeah. So basically, if you want to see our content, you're going to want to go on our YouTube, because that's where we're going to be shoving, or we're going to be putting a lot of content out right now. But we will be on Twitch. We're going to try to do a podcast every single week. So if you like what you saw today, we're probably going to be doing one next week sometime. So, you know, we're just letting you know. So give us a follow so you know when we get online. So
yeah, and I also have a separate YouTube channel too. If you know, so there's two channels that we put content up. Orphis Gaming is my associate channel to Barricade Brothers. Barricade Brothers was started by me and Peter and our buddy Clay, and I started Orphis Gaming. I'm Orphis. This is Pete Skeet. Clay is Clazerbeam. I started Orphis Gaming, I want to say roughly a year and a half to 2 years after we started Barricade Brothers. One of the big reasons I did is it was hard for all three of us, or the two of us, to find time to play. And I was able to find time for myself to make videos and upload. So I created a separate channel to put those videos up.
Yeah, we felt it'd be kind of awkward if our channel had just him all the time.
Barricade Brothers, and it was only me being uploaded.
So we kind of put it on halt for a little while. We're actually finding some time. We're getting things together. We're actually coming up with plans. So we're by the end of this year, we're going to have our channel up and running like a well-oiled machine. We're going to have videos coming up on a schedule. We're going to have a bunch of different content. We're going to be doing podcasts. We're going to be trying, you know, things out every here and there. Thanks, Taco. I appreciate it, man.
We really appreciate the support.
But yeah, so like I said, the last couple of years have been a little rough because, you know, I jumped from an old job to a new job. He jumped from a couple jobs. And he has a family. You know, I have a girlfriend. Clay's got a family. So it's been a little rough for us to get it together, but we actually found some time to sit down, and we're actually, after this stream, we're actually going to be sitting down and doing some more planning. So we're going to be letting you guys know how things are going. So yeah,
the further ahead, I think that we think the better our content is going to be as it comes out. Gig games. My hobby would probably have to be gaming.
Yeah, I'd say.
Probably
gaming is probably my biggest hobby. I like also working on car audio systems, so porn is also a great thing, Flappy. Yeah,
right.
I do like porn.
I wouldn't say porn is my hobby, but I definitely partake from time to time.
not quite a hobby, but it's definitely fun to jump in on that.
Yeah, I tried building model cars once and that just didn't cut it.
So yeah, as soon as we're done with this, we're actually going to start uploading it to our channel. If you wanted to go through, if you join in at the end, you want to find out what we talked about, it's going to be up there pretty soon. So we're actually going to cut the stream here. So if you want to join us in chat again, you know, we're more than happy to. My arm size.
What is your arm size?
I don't know mine. Do you know yours?
What, bicep wise?
Yeah. What do you mean? What part of your arm? Like bicep, triceps, forearms.
I always describe the size of my arm like this. My arm is roughly the same size as my cock.
Jesus Christ. I actually drive a 2015 Fusion. So, but yeah, anyways, if you guys want to check out this, the podcast from earlier, you know, just check out our channel. And we will be doing this again next week, so if you guys want to join, we're more than happy to have you guys in the chat. You know, if we have you guys to talk to, then we have, you know, we can
more,
come up with more to talk
more
about.
More content, right. And obviously we're going to come up with our own content, but when we get feedback from viewers, you know, it helps us more. And, you know, while you're watching, feel free to make any suggestions or any type of, you know, game you want to watch us play during our stream, our podcast, or during, or, you know, videos you want to see us upload, play and upload, you know, any ideas you have, we'll listen. Doesn't mean we're going to do them, but if it's a good idea, we'll listen, and we'll give you a shout out for the idea.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, so thanks for coming out, guys. Really appreciate it. So We're gonna end it right here. So catch it. We're gonna be doing this next week sometime. I don't know what day yet, but just look out for it. So,
If you want to subscribe to our Facebook channel, you can do that, and we'll make sure we keep you updated on there. And anytime we're streaming, if you're following us on Twitch, then anytime we're streaming, you'll be able to catch us. So, but anybody, all you guys that are watching right now, we appreciate you watching. We appreciate any feedback that you had, and we hope that you catch us next time. So until next time, this is Orphis,
Pete Skeet,
and Pete Skeet from the Barricade Brothers, our Barricast number first podcast, and we'll see you next time. Thanks, guys.
See you later, guys.